You know the nature. We got nature everywhere you go. Nature on the street, nature in the disco. Ah, when I rub up just my baby, yeah, yeah. Ah, it makes me feel hot. It makes me feel hot. Yeah. Oh, my body get warm, yeah, yeah. My body get warm, yeah, yeah, yeah. Can I get a little more nature? Yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, fellas. Oh, yeah, yeah. We all need nature, yeah. Nature for your baby, yeah, yeah. I'd hate to be here without nature. You know, yeah. You know.
For any of you who have been around, say, for the last 25 years in America, then you know that there has been a phenomenon on the scene known as rhythm and blues, and rhythm and blues goes back farther than that. Eventually, it goes back 400 years, maybe 1,000 years, depending on whether you look at Africa or America. But there's one person for the last 25 years who has been what you might call a living legend, a person who's done a lot for the business and a person who's done a lot for black culture and for the culture of humanity. And that is James Brown. Good to have you here.
Nice to be here. And hey, I just listened to the opening. And I wonder, I really deserve all that, you know?
I would say so. I would say so. Very. And, you know, that's, you can judge that just from the fact that when you walked in the studio, it was like, I don't know, how can you put it? It's like magic. I mean, you know, people just all of a sudden form around you to meet James Brown.
I think one of the things, I've been sincere and I've been honest with what I had to say. And I'm very glad I didn't get a chance to get a formal education, because, like we were talking earlier.
How far in school did you go?
Seventh grade.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Shine shoes, right?
Right.
Worked, did you say one time?
Sawmill, picking cotton, hoeing cotton, working hay.
Hard work.
Yeah, real hard work. Real, real hard work, you know. I was a junior at the Link with the age of 16, and I had to, I used to bust rocks and everything. I know the whole thing, and I'm glad I know it, because it gave me, we have a seventh grade education formula, but a doctor's degree in the street. I know what it's about.
A lot of people today don't have the kind of philosophy that you do. A lot of young people, I know you do a lot for young people. They don't know what it is to struggle, it seems. A lot of people get things very easy. When you talk to a group of young people, what do you say to them?
That's one of the things I clarified right away. I let them know that they don't know. And I try to you know, impress upon them the fact that they, what they are talking about is, they're a long ways from it, but they are getting some of the delayed action that are still there. The fragments are still there, which are coming together and making a whole molecule and basic around. Can back to the same thing, but it's going back a little bit more sophisticated this time.
Talking about going back to the same thing, a lot of people think of you, James Brown, as only an entertainer. When I say only an entertainer, they see you on stage and, you know, think about Lickin' Stick, Cold Sweat, or anything. I can go back, Night Train, so on. But the point is, you, I would say, are a total human being. You were telling me about the title of a new show that you're doing.
Called James Brown World of Love. We going to start shooting it from L.A. pretty soon.
And this is your production. You
yes,
control everything on it.
Yes. Control I must have of myself. Then I won't, either that or I can't give you James
Brown. Why is that so important?
So important because if I've got to speak somebody else's tongue, it wouldn't be me. And then I would be doing my people who believe in me an injustice, you know.
Do you think
the people who follow James Brown throughout the years?
Do you think that's important for other people in addition to you? I mean, let's say, for instance, for people in general, for a number of people who may be or have found themselves in a similar situation like you.
It's important for every artist, regardless of whether it's music or sports or what have you. They should be able to project themselves, because the one reason why people pick you. For that particular spot or where or whatever, or their hero or what have you. But they put you in that spot of being somebody they respect or somebody they idolize, what have you, then they respect you for being yourself. It's got to be something new. Mm-hmm. And either new in this era. And if you, when you don't do that, you're not being fair to yourself, to them, or to the profession. So you must be able to do yourself to an extent. Things have gotten real bad because today singers don't have no control over nothing. They don't know what they're going to sing. The music is always prepared for them. And they've gone as far as today with disco of not using live performers to make a record. They're making them all mechanical. And I told my people about this about a month ago, before they even talked about it over national television. You know. But I knew that they weren't using... Like, the musicians are really working themselves out of the work.
You started what might be called today disco.
The real disco.
Yeah, 25 years ago.
And it's getting back to that real hard. Mm-hmm. You know, the radio stations, I own three radio stations myself, and we don't even play the real disco. So the real disco has to be heard in a disco.
What kinds of things do you play? I know there was a reason why you bought those radio stations.
Well, during that revolution time, I played things that nobody would play. And I played...
The 60s, you're talking
about. That's right. And I did a lot of revolution stuff. And then I said a lot of things openly nobody would say. And I erased a lot of slangs and things, you know. Some of the words that I thought were out of date at that time, you know, color people, Negroes, whatever. I thought that was yesterday. If you want to be, a man should be what he is, and then from there, go to people. I first thought we should claim true identity as black people, and then from there, get away from all color and what have you. There's certain days, you know, like we should celebrate Emancipation Day, and we should find about a lot of our leaders and the forefathers and the forerunners of yesterday and also celebrate those days. But by the same token, we should celebrate humanity together.
Now, you've been around the world speaking about humanity together, and you're accepted everywhere. I mean, people of all colors, cultures, and so on. Do you think, just given some of the recent things that have happened, like, I don't know if you're familiar with the Bakke case and the rise of the Klan again, the rise of the Nazi Party and all, do you think people of different cultures and different races in the world are coming closer together, or is it getting farther apart?
Total repeat. Mm-hmm. Everything's repeat. It's going to be sophisticated, you know. Naturally, if there's no more cotton field, then it's even worse, because if there's no cotton field, and I had to go to work today and didn't have James Brown hanging over my head to kind of go through on, I would have no job.
So you'd be just like anybody else?
No, I'd be worse off than I would in my other era. In the era that I come up in, I'd be worse off today, because today I have no job. You know, it's like low pay versus no pay.
Now let's take that. You were fortunate. You were what you call, you told me yesterday at the airport, lucky.
Lucky.
What do you mean by that? You were lucky. I mean, you obviously have talents that a lot of people don't have. You obviously have been successful where a lot of people haven't.
I know what I'm going to do. It hadn't been documented, the things I'm doing. They documented as much as they could. They can't really write my stuff. And I know that if the establishment just leave me alone, that I'll lead for another 10 or 15 or 20 years. Because it's something that they won't allow everybody to know about. What I am, I'm doing the people. And when you're doing the people, that's not race, creed, or color, that's the people, period. Mm-hmm. I'm doing the people. And the people has never been represented 100% on television. I guess this television station, this type of station, will give you more in depth than any other station will. The other station can't afford to. You know, like an educational radio station. It's going to be more together than a normal station. So this is it. I mean, then you'll get more of the people here than you will any place. And, you know, you know how far you're going to go.
That naturally flows right into your television show. Now, a lot of entertainers have been around. I think I told you yesterday also, we were talking about, you know, why it was that Donnie and Marie Osmond, not specifically Donnie and Marie, Donnie and Marie and a lot of other people who I would say, just candidly, don't have the talent, the background, and the experience that you have, ended up on national television, and you had to start your own show. Are you at all concerned about that kind of thing?
I'm concerned, but I preached 12, 15 years ago, right? And I preached up until today. And I guess we're getting a conversation. I'm still preaching. But by the same token, so much has been written about me. It's unfortunate for us that Black America couldn't give me what it could, but we're not organized as a people because of education, a lot of other things. I'm sure we all want to do better, and the whole world want to do better. I mean, we see that in the Middle East, we see it in Africa, whatever, Asia, what have you, all over the world. But there's an education barrier, and, you know, people can only be as strong as they know how to be, right?
That's
you understand
true.
Me?
I got you.
Okay. Well, I can talk with you. Since there's certain things I can get across to you, I can't get across to my dad. Okay? Yeah, it bothers me. But what can I do? I know within myself, if they walk on the stage, they got a problem. Mm-hmm. You name the act, it'll make a difference. Individually, leave that alone. Mm-hmm. Until I get a little bit older, and a little bit tired of it. Right now, I don't worry about that, right. You know. But by the same token, there's still a cotton field. And what they're doing is, you look on, you see a Saturday Night Fever, you see all the disco shows, you see repercussions of James Brown, things I done got tired of doing.
Right.
You know?
It's right back to the
And all they got to do is come down to the show and watch what I'm doing now. You know, we did some of the reviews, but, you know, like on the back of my new album, Jam,
1980s, right?
Well, I was wearing that suit 3 years ago, but Star Wars just started bringing out last week.
I know every time I ever went to a James Brown concert that...
And I designed it too.
I know, I could always expect, and everybody could always expect to see something new, you know, like that. You did things and you are doing things, as we said, that a lot of people haven't done. And I know songs like Hell, and a lot of other things make people think. When you sit down and write...
Hell frightened them, though.
Okay,
you know?
Right.
Right after the Payback, I thought I'd get a little bit more in depth, right? I said, okay, you heard of the Payback now, but I'll let you know that you're living in hell each and every day. The hell that you talk about, you're living in that, you know. Mm-hmm. It's hell when you spend your whole life, you know, doing something, and you still wind up paying dues from the day you're born to the day you die. And what are you talking about, you know? And you get on your knees every night, and you pray, and you do all those different things, or you go and worship at your church or your temple or whatever, and you still wind up doing the same thing. So there are certain things that has to be done. I give a lot of credit to Reverend Ike, mind power. You have to go into that. I had that in Payback. Mm-hmm. We must have the mind, because even the scriptures say you got to make one step, you know.
Are you a very religious person?
I'm a religious man, because a man must believe in something, you know. I know I believe in myself, too. I'm religious that way, too. I'm religiously believing in James Brown. But also, I believe in a supreme being. I have to do that.
Okay, you just made a movie, and your movie is Saturday Night Fever for real. I mean, it's pre-Saturday Night Fever.
That's right.
I understand it's about your life.
It's about my life and my struggle and the places I've gone, my philosophy and what I had to say. And it's me behind closed doors. You even see me at my home, which I don't really show my home.
Is it like a documentary?
It's a documentary. Plus entertainment musically as well. It's good for the head and the feet.
And are you controlling everything behind that? I mean the economics and so on?
Economically, I'm heavily involved, halfway, you know, something like that. But the main thing that should be done or should be brought out is brought out, you know. And economically would be probably the last thing that happened from it. But that's not the thing that worried me. Other than the true story being told, and to tell it this way. Roots was probably one of the greatest things that ever been done on television. And if you see this, you say this is equally as good. And it's another step. It's a step beyond that. Roots showed what happened to us, period. And it didn't speak of the solution as much as this shows you.
You suggest some solutions.
This shows you the solution being, yes, right, okay. Being worked out.
Now,
let me say this. I want to get this across.
Okay, go ahead.
To put out a television show, and in each town where it's shown, you have actually people watching, it has the highest rating. We beat out all nighttime television, all our strong nighttime shows.
You're talking about...
The Carsons, I'll name it all.
Future Shock.
Future Shock. But I mean, we beat out the nighttime shows that were right up the Carsons, we beat them out. And it wasn't listed, you know.
Why do you think that was?
Well, it was listed, but they didn't pick up on it. Well, the same reason that we're still marching. It's funny, you know. It's funny to me. You know, it's funny to me.
So would you
see a man, to let a man look at me and say, I'm 44. Today, I'm 45. Today, I'm 45 years old.
Today?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Today,
okay.
I'm 45.
Happy birthday. I wish we had something to give you. But
thank you very much.
Only thing we can give you.
When a man tell his age, I think he should do something. See, a man should do his thing.
Okay, that's cool.
I'm sorry.
Okay, and Saturday. And you can see more of that this week at the Latin Court.
No, I just thought it was. I thought it would be kind of like a joke, you know, to tell your age, you know.
But I know.
And say which way you're going.
Now, you know? I know when my parents were 45, they could not do that. How have you managed to be able to do that?
Because I got the opportunity, and I was sure I wasn't going to blow it, because if I blew that opportunity, I would blow some opportunities for you and a lot of people in this control room and a lot of you sitting out there. I know I'm a model man. I know it takes 4 and 5 in the morning. I'd be writing songs, putting things together, and people give me a chance to live 3 or 4 times to their once not living. I owe that to the people, and especially owe it to the poor people, and I owe it to the ghetto, and I even owe it to the rich, ignorant people that don't know the truth. So for them to see me continue to go on, and if they got kids out there 12 and 15 years old, I can get out there and outdance them, I think this tells them something. You know, if I'd gotten everything I should have gotten, I'd be an old man, and I'd be blown down, right?
Indeed.
But I'm still trying to get the recognition that you're fighting for each and every day, that the poor people, the farmers, and everybody trying to get across.
I think that keeps me going.
Yeah,
I think you mentioned something in that's extremely significant. That is that you said that a number of people have given you what you need to go on, even though they haven't made it for themselves.
That's right.
Do you think that's important? I know you said this before, but maybe I'd just like to sort of reemphasize it. Mm-hmm. A lot of people think that the struggle, quote unquote, is over, that mm-hmm. we've made it. That
it's worse than it ever was. Because at one point we were being heard. Today you're not anymore. Not heard anymore. Mm-hmm. If you think, sing a lot, any one group that are really, I mean, I'm not knocking anybody. But we must, the struggle is not over. But the success of it has ceased a lot. Mm-hmm. Has ceased because we don't have our direction together.
Now. What do you think we really have to do? I know that's a heavy order to ask you.
We got to go to the government and get all the money that they got, period, to give poor people and uneducated people so they can get qualified. They're having a race that starts at 5 o'clock in the evening, and this is a parable. There's a race that starts 5 o'clock in the evening, right? And by the time we hear about it, it's 10 o'clock. And yet still, the race is gonna run for 10 hours, and they expect us to come 5 hours late and be competitive. And this is where we are as far as the market is concerned. So we gotta get all the education that we can to know what to do. And then after that, then we've got to pool our positions and our wealth together and create jobs for the people that have it.
Like, you know? I would assume that you posed an example, the radio station.
I did all of that,
television.
And the system cut me right down, and I was tell you very proudly, they cut me right down, but I didn't lose my stuff, but they cut me down.
You mean just in terms of the change of from the ownership of King Records to you're working for Polydor and so forth?
Well, I didn't own King, but I have more with the record company I'm with.
Right.
And I have basically the same control because of the fact that I had it, you know, printed in my contract. It was put in my contract before I signed it. But by the same token, King Records was a small label. And that small label, I was able to do more things. Yeah. But it's happening now with Polydor because of the fact that with Polydor, I'm the only world attraction. I'm the only attraction in the world that sells in every country. Now, that's not saying I'm the biggest attraction in maybe in this city or that country, but I'm the only attraction that sells in every country in the world. See, because I'm with a world company.
Okay, I just want to.
You want me to say that?
I want to stop on that note, and I want you to say that too. I know we could go on and on and on because we were sitting here and talking maybe an hour just about you before you got here. But I would like to say for you and for everybody that's watching that it's truly edifying for me to have this opportunity to be here on the same stage with you. and say this, and I hope that everybody has enjoyed what we have to say, and most importantly, have learned. And I'd just like to invite you to see James at the Latin Quarter, and what else can I say?
I'd like to say to all the people who give me a chance to say to live maybe five times, and they didn't get a chance to live one time. I'd like to say, I hope they get a chance to live 200 years, and I live 200 years minus one day. So I'll never know beautiful people like you passed away. God bless you and I love you.
Thank you.
Go at nature to the head. Talk about.
That, of course, was James Brown, and we hope you enjoyed that as much as we enjoyed doing that interview. That's only reflective of part of the things that we're going to be doing for the rest of this month, and I thought we'd run that show sort of short so we could give you an opportunity to preview the upcoming events here on Detroit Black Journal. We have approximately six more weeks in this season to go, and we got some very exciting things coming up. First of all, next week starts with a group by the name of Griot Galaxy that's making quite a name for itself around the city. Take a look at this. Was Griot Galaxy, Farouk and everybody, and they'll be here at this time next week, May 11th at 8 p.m., and we hope you tune in then and enjoy Griot Galaxy. That will feature interviews and also live performances by them here in our studios. Also, we don't want to miss and we don't want to forget, as a lot of people perhaps have, but we haven't, Malcolm X, who almost 13 years ago in February, in fact, was assassinated in Harlem. And we want to focus in on that assassination and the problems involved in it. Also, the man and his time. Malcolm X, that's on May 18th, 2 weeks from today. Take a look at this.
It was kind of rugged, really.
After his release from prison, Malcolm X became a minister for the Nation of Islam. In his autobiography, Malcolm X said, "No sane black man really wants integration. No sane white man really wants integration. The only solution is complete separation from the white man."
And one of the facts in your estimation is that Negro and white can never live together in America.
Evidently, the white man feels that the Negro can never live with him because it's the white man who is stopping integration. I'm not the one who is stopping Negroes from integrating with whites. I'm not the one who keeps Negroes from integrating white schools, and so don't put the burden of proof on me. It is the white man himself who is guilty, and whose guilt proves that the Negro and the white man can't live side by side. Now, if I'm wrong in saying they can't, just prove that I'm wrong by doing it, or just show me one place where it's done. If it can't be done in New York City, it won't be done anywhere in this country.
Malcolm X became one of the best-known ministers in the Nation of Islam, but he was silenced for 90 days after the assassination of President Kennedy.
Malcolm, would I be correct in saying you're going to initiate a new movement in this country?
No, I don't think I'm equipped to initiate a new movement, but it's my intention to take the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and make them work on a broader level.
Mm-hmm. How long has this been building up, this decision to make the change?
Well, I have been able to see for some time that that I do run into obstacles in trying to help him within the movement. So I want to help him just that much. So it's my intention to try and do it now in the only way that I know how. And I think I can do it better without the restrictions that I would run into by being a part of the Muslim movement in this country. That is, the Muslim movement as it now exists.
How severe were the restrictions these past 90 days?
Oh, during the past 90 days, they were most severe. I've been completely silent.
Not able to talk is a real affliction for you, is that right?
Not only have I not been able to speak as a Muslim, I haven't even been able to speak as a man.
Actually, going back to that incident, you have told me on other occasions that you didn't actually say you were glad the president was dead. What did you say, Malcolm?
No, my subject that day was God's judgment of white America. And I showed the different incidents that had been building up, step by step, the fulfillment of prophecy, and that all of these things that were taking place were the result of some seeds that were badly sown, or some bad seeds that were sown. And the death of the president I referred to as the result of other things, a combination of things. And surprisingly, this is what the whole country was saying, that it was a climate of hate. So chickens coming home to roost means the same thing.
And this is what you said, chickens were coming home to roost.
Yes.
But in no time did you say you were glad the president...
No, I did say this, that it pleases me to see that the wisdom of the prophets, these ancient prophets, was so vast that they could foresee these things exactly as they were to come to pass thousands of years ago. This was part of my lecture that day, mm-hmm. And they twisted it.
In April 1964, Malcolm made his first pilgrimage to Mecca.
Malcolm, on your trip abroad, you said you sensed a feeling of great brotherhood, and that conceivably you would be working toward integration in this country now. At least this is what you're reported to have said. Have you any comment on it?
I don't think that I ever mentioned anything about working toward integration.
Talk about nature. Talk about nature. I wanna go back. Look at here.